President of FICCI, Mr. Rashesh Shah, Senior Vice President, Mr. Somani, immediate past President, Mr. Pankaj Patel, my colleague, Mr. Neeraj Gupta and Rajiv Kumar, other office bearers, ladies and gentlemen. There is so much said about the budget already in the last 4 days that there is hardly anything new to add. And I'm sure all of you must have seen various press interactions through which we have tried to answer so many questions. In fact, today morning I went for a function in another chamber where the office bearer himself said that there are hardly any questions now, and if anybody from this crowd wants to ask a question to Mr. Adia, I can also reply to it. So much of dissemination of information about budget has happened through various media channels and so many other medium. Well, basically, I just want to tell you the background in which we prepared this budget and what went into making of this budget. So we had behind us, before the date of this budget, two major structural reforms which were done in the Indian economy. One of them was demonetization, the second GST. And I wouldn't call demonetization as one of the event. It was one of the events in the series of steps which the government has taken for reducing the cash economy, size of the cash economy. It's a series of action for anti-avoidance, for reducing the black economy. And in that series, one of the bigger one was demonetization, but there are so many other small steps which the government has taken systematically with a view to reduce the size of cash economy and to increase the tax buoyancy of direct taxes. Now, with whether it is a case of shell companies being deregistered, or it's a case of even bringing Benami law in its new avatar, or it is a question of amendment of PMLA, or creation of a task force on black money. All these are steps in the direction of that. The second reform of GST was intended to improve the tax, of course, apart from simplification of taxation, indirect taxation system, it was meant to improve the tax buoyancy of both direct as well as indirect tax. And fortunately for us, even before we had the budget, we have come out of the small transitory adverse effect of these two reforms. For 2-3 quarters, our GDP growth rate was affected, but not only because of this, but also because of global factors. Fortunately, now the global situation has also improved in terms of GDP growth rate of other countries. Exports growth rate globally has gone up, and so also India's export growth rate has gone up. And from the result we saw for the second quarter of 17-18, we already now started the journey upward. So it's a V turn that we have taken already. And from all the indicators hereafter, which have come in November, December, and also our tax indicators of corporate income tax, advance tax, we can clearly see that the situation is now completely turning around and it's improving. So it is in this context that we made the budget. Two things are predominant in this budget. One is our desire to do something for rural economy, including agriculture. Agriculture is only one subset of the rural economy. But the idea is that if we can somehow put more money, both on from the budget and off budget resources into the rural area, then apart from helping the people who need some help, it will also rejuvenate the consumer demand in rural area. And that will help all of us in terms of increasing the capacity, utilization of the industry, and then bringing new investment. So that's the whole idea. So we have done a lot in that respect in this budget. Everybody has talked about it. It has been hailed as the budget for the rural area, for the farmers. The second part of our budget, which is the highlight of the budget, is the MSME and the employment generation. Now, it's very important for us to give full strength to the MSME sector, because it is the MSME sector which is the not the backbone, but it is the middle portion of our entire economy, which it sustains. And it is also sometimes a link between the big industry and the small individual enterprises and the consumers also. So the MSME needs some strength, and that is why many of our programs which are announced in the budget are also relating to MSME and employment generation. The most important demand of the MSME is they should be able to get their payment from the OEM buyer in time. And the second is, if they don't get it in time, they should get credit in time. And these are the demands which we are trying to meet with in the budget proposal. And I'll request my colleague Rajiv Kumar to dwell upon this topic of how we are targeting MSME for funding now. Even the bank recapitalization which has happened, and I must compliment my younger colleague who has just come before a few days, has made a lot of difference to the department in terms of helping the government come to a consensus on the issue of recapitalization, and not only that, working out all the modalities of recapitalization, bank recapitalization. And today, that problem is also behind us now. So that is something which Rajiv Kumar has made it possible, and it'll be very interesting to listen to him on what are his plans for MSME, because this entire recap will be used for leveraging 5 lakh crore of credit, which will mainly go to MSME. So that is the plan that we have, and he will talk more about it. Of course, I would like to mention to you that whatever good is done is always forgotten by all of you. So in the morning meeting in CII, I said that if I would have come to this meeting 2 years ago, then the first question that would have come is, when are you bringing GST? And in today's meeting, out of all the speakers, nobody even talked about GST. I mean, as if it is a thing which is taken for granted now. GST is done and we have got it and we are satisfied. Now tell us, what about this, what about this? I remember when I came to Department of Financial Services first in Government of India, everybody said ki insurance, 75%, allowing 74% in insurance sector, FDI. That is what is blocking the whole development, as if. So we worked for it, worked with the committee, took it to the parliament, got it passed, fortunately. Even Rajya Sabha passed it. A bill which was pending for 8 years. But very soon it was forgotten, and I don't know what amount of development it brought and what difference did it make to the economy. But then we start talking about something and then we get obsessed about it, and then when we achieve it, we forget about it. And then came the next demand about some Big Bang reform. When one of them came, everybody said, we have got enough of it. Now, nobody talks about Big Bang reform. Then came the GST demand. GST also happened. And today, it's a done thing. Okay, ho gaya GST, nothing to worry about it. And then came the bank recapitalization. That also has happened now. So I'm wondering what is going to be the next demand from the chambers now. So, but talking of the disinvestment, you know, I mean, he will tell you there was a time, he has all the statistics of how much disinvestment happened in the last 10 years prior to this government and what has happened in the last 4 years of this government, or three and a half, 4 years. If next year's target of 80,000 crore for disinvestment is very large target, but if you had kept this target 3 years ago in the budget, people would say, are you going mad or what? Even the target of 65,000 crore was being challenged. Matlab, in the TV debate after the year when we had set up a target of 65,000 crore, they had said, this is too ambitious, you can't do it. And now that we have done 1 lakh crore in the current year, one question which came from everybody is, why have you been less ambitious in keeping 80,000 crore? So that's what happens, you know. So there's no end to our desires to achieve more and more. But must compliment Neeraj Gupta also, because he's done wonderful work in disinvestment. Instead of only selling the shares of PSU which are with us, he has used variety of instruments to do the disinvestment. And because of his deep knowledge of the capital market, he has brought in ETF and a lot of other instruments. So, and very innovative way in which the disinvestment has been done, and he has got us the revenue. So I must compliment him for that. And it will be very interesting to listen to his experiences today. So what I wanted to say is that, yes, in the budget, our focus has been rural, agriculture, and MSME. And that's what we require now. A bit of a help is required for handholding to MSME, even post-GST. But must compliment all the MSMEs of this country that so many of them have registered for regular tax payment under GST and not under the composition scheme. Under the composition scheme, although the limit is 1 crore, but still, many of them with even turnover as less as 20 lakhs have registered for regular payment of taxes, because they want to take input tax credit for whatever taxes they are paying. So these are the broad points I wanted to make. I don't think there is any other point that I can think of, unless there is anybody who has one or two questions on which I can respond. And then I'd like to apologize for leaving a little early, because so much of work is held up in the office. We were all busy for the last 5-6 days in budget making. And then 2 days off, I was out of station. So there's a lot of pending work in the office. So I'd like to go and finish that. So any question, one or two questions, some remark or somebody? Not from the journalists. From the members of the FICCI.
Can you get the mic, please, to Mr. Modi? Quickly.
Sir, my suggestion is, I have a suggestion, not any question, that you have very rightly described the MAT credit on the bankruptcy court. There is a revision. But I would have thought that the same is true for an existing company if it is running in loss and then turns into profit. Unfortunately, for an existing company, the past losses are not allowed to be taken into care. Now that I think you have realized that for bankruptcy, you are allowing a new company to do that, but existing company is not allowed. So maybe it is time that it can be looked into. And secondly, sir, I must compliment you were mentioning about GST. Most of the us were doubtful that within a year you can stabilize it. But it has taken only 6 months and it is stabilized. So obviously you are doing something right.
Thank you. I have noted the suggestion for next year's budget, the first one.
Sir, thank you for a number of suggestions in the budget which we discussed before you came in, and we very much welcome. When FICCI had come down and met up with you, sir, when we're doing the pre-budget consultations, one of the issues which we had tabled was regard to Section 56, where a transfer at less than market value is regarded as deemed income of the recipient. And sir, when we discussed with you, you felt that there was prima facie merit in leaving this provision only for real estate as opposed to for any movable property. That section, there has been only one change which has been brought about, which is a merger of a holding company into subsidiary or vice versa. But that section remains totally unaddressed, and there are a number of suggestions that we had made, only one of which has been incorporated. And we would request, sir, that if the Section 56 can be re-looked at it, because that's causing enormous... So for example, sir, if you recollect, we had put a proposition to you that if there is an acquisition of shares from a promoter, thereafter an open offer is made, the shares from the promoter can be transferred only after 2 months, by which time the price of shares would have varied. And therefore, there is a deemed income or a loss, which is not actually there. All the QIPs are impacted by this provision. And when we had narrated that to you, you felt there was a merit in relooking. Probably, sir, it has not happened. And we would suggest you have a relook at it, sir.
Okay. You are talking about Section 56.
That's right, sir.
Does that also cover this angel tax? No.
Angel tax is separate, sir. 56 okay. Basically says that if there is any transfer of any asset at less than fair value, the difference will be regarded as income of the recipient. And when we pointed out to you that all QIPs happen at a particular price which is approved by SEBI, but by the time the allotment happens, the date is different. And therefore, there is a deemed income. Similarly, all takeovers, so wherever you go to SEBI, SEBI gives an approval, thereafter an open offer happens, the actual transfer takes place after 2 or 3 months. So all of those are deemed cases. That issue has not been addressed, sir. When we had discussed...
But there was one issue which came about valuation of the unlisted shares, mainly of the startups, you know, what this journalists call it an angel tax or something like that. There's no angel tax as such. it's a provision, same provision, which says that if you transfer shares... at a price which is more than the value of the company.
Yes, then the deemed, it's a deemed
then
income.
Then it will be deemed income, you know.
And that's
now,
a
let me tell you that in order to protect the genuine startups, what is there in that thing is that if that is a buyout by, if that investment in that company is made, unlisted company, by a venture capital fund, then there is no such question asked.
Absolutely.
We don't even question it. Then secondly, if it is a non-resident who is also making this investment, we don't ask any question. So there is a second protection. The third, if that startup is registered with DIPP as a startup, within the definition of startup with DIPP is given, and DIPP has got a committee to look into that, to register startups. So if you are registered as a startup, then also no questions are asked. Otherwise, also, in case of most of such transfers, it should only be borne out by the valuation method, either the book value or the DCF value, discounted cash flow method. And we normally accept the certificate of a chartered accountant. But only in cases where we suspect it is a non-genuine transaction, where it is a transaction to sort of, you know, for only profit shifting, then only we try to get into it. So that is, I just wanted to clarify thing.
And sir,
there are a lot of protections available for unlisted equity companies, which are startups, you know, for that.
Sir, I would actually very wholeheartedly subscribe. There are enough and more inbuilt provisions there which safeguard. If people are screaming still that it is unfair, I would not agree with that. This section 56 is one thing I would like to leave for your kind consideration. The other thing, sir, is that we have introduced long-term capital gains tax. And the issue there was, sir, that it's a new tax which will come in. And we are providing that there is a grandfathering. And the cost or the market value as at 31st January will be the price which taken. And I've gone through the FAQs, very well drafted and come out in good time. There are few peculiar situations which arise, sir. So let's say there are two companies and they are merging. Now, in the amalgamating company's shareholders would not have held the shares of the amalgamated company on 31st January. That will come into effect only later on. And therefore, I can give you half a dozen such instances and I won't take a lot of your time. But we as FICCI will be making a representation to you. So the law exempts certain transfers and grants grandfathering. Those provisions need to be pari materia incorporated even in the LTCG regime, sir.
So we look into that. Those are individual kuch cases hote hai, aise stray prakar ke. Uska humko bhej dijiye. We will clarify on those also.
Thank you,
Rajiv,
sir. Thank you.
Rajiv Vastapal.
Sir, I have another couple of questions. Sir, just one suggestion for your consideration, sir. Sir, for the last 50 years, we have seen.
Hi, my name is Harjinder. I'm also the vice president of Women Wing of FICCI, sir. So my question to you is, as an extension of gender responsive budget, you increase the budget allocation, which are compliments to you. But can I also request, as an extension of this, you know, in case you could extend this CGT MSE scheme, which is there, could be extended more towards women-owned enterprise. You see, what happens when a woman goes for, having this additional sort of revenue or additional sort of credit facility from a banking company or a financial institution. So she is asked for additional collateral, and given the social setup that we have in India, a woman may not have many collaterals to offer. So to promote women and entrepreneurship in the country, if I can request you this, you know, that CGT MSE could be extended to women-owned enterprise. And secondly, you know, when you go to these financial institutes or to the banks and you say it's a women-owned enterprise, the question is, what is women-owned enterprise? So if you can define, is it 80% of the shareholding that a woman has, or 90%, or what is it? What is the definition of a women-owned enterprise so that, you know, it can push further the women-owned enterprise in this country? Thank you.
It's a good suggestion. My colleague Raju Kumar deals with the CGTME and he will respond to that.
I have a...
Yeah.
So to you and Raju Kumar both, basically it is... Yesterday, you know, we won the match, but before winning, you know, lunch was called, and Virendra Sehwag made a comment on a tweet that they are, South African empires and other empires, empires are treating us like, you know, PSU banks treating MSME. He made a comment that way. And many a places I have seen that under 2 crore, without collateral, MSME can get it. Limit was raised from 1 crore to 2 crore. The bank says, we are not given in 1 crore. How can you expect in 2 crore? A and B, the kind of delays and kind of queries they raise is impossible to run or expand or capitalize MSME.
He will respond to it when he speaks on this. Okay. You want to take any more?
This is, now it's working. One quick point, and there is not too much information in the public domain about that. There was a mention in the budget speech about outward foreign investment. There are already prescribed guidelines. There are restrictions in terms of how much outward foreign investment can an Indian company do. Is there any thinking behind that? Would you like to share some more details around that?
It's only the thinking. It'll come out when the committee meets, you know, some... deliberations will take place, but right now what is mentioned in the budget is that the government will rationalize the guidelines for this. So we have not yet firmed up anything. So once we firm up, we'll let you know, as of now.
So there's only one suggestion. In the last 50 years, we have seen that whatever has been the taxes which have been deducted at source, the deductee has been getting credit for the taxes deducted at source. Initially, it was on the strength of a certificate given by the tax deductor. Subsequently, the credit was being given on the strength of 26 AS. So my suggestion is that if you could kindly consider for adopting a same policy which has worked well for the last 50 years in the context of GST, once the supplier uploads his invoice, that means whatever is the tax GST payable on that, the government has got it. On the strength of that, the recipient should get a credit. One should not wait for a match and mismatch for between the supplier and the recipient.
We'll look into that suggestion. Good. Okay. So I thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
I think after thanking Dr. Adia for his comments as well as for his responses to our questions, may I now request Sri Rajiv Kumar to give his address. And
Mr. Shah, Chairperson of FICCI, Mr. Patel, Mr. Somani, DG Mr. Shenoy, my senior colleague Mr. Neeraj Gupta, delegates of this very important, powerful committee, the Executive Committee. Very good evening to all of you. At the beginning, let me admit that I am just 4 months old on the job, and all of you know much more than me. So I am here to learn from you more and to sort of take it home and then work on it rather than tell you anything. But as mentioned by the Finance Secretary, the entire economy and the country is going through the structural changes which are transformational. He has mentioned about all other things, including the demonetization, the GST. There are many other things which are happening simultaneously. The IBC is also changing the entire landscape of the relationship that exists or existed before. Another very important thing which is again structural is the devolution which has been changed. That is the 14th Finance Commission devolution which has increased to 42% for these states from 32 to 42. So that also changed the entire relationship in the fiscal federalism. So there are a number of changes, and as mentioned by the Finance Secretary in terms of GST, he has stated everything. But that is a fantastic example of the cooperative federalism. And it opens up many more areas of similar kind of pooling the sovereign powers together. There are a whole lot of issues in terms of education, in terms of rivers, in terms of whole lot of things. So land, all those areas, this has shown the way as to how the states and center can come together and do whole lot of initiatives combinedly. So these are all transformational changes. The digitization which is taking place, connecting of panchayats which is taking place at a pace. These are fundamentally changing the very, very nature of the economy. The kind of data points which all these transformational changes are creating Imagine that when the data points talk to each other, it's a tremendous scope for the analytics, for the technology-driven business, and for a clean business. So this is how the power of these transformational changes is. I come now to, because that's I am expected to say, is about the banking. You all are aware more than me that after the asset quality review, suddenly the quantum of the stressed assets was standard suddenly increased to close to 7.7 lakh crores. And imagine that these were the accounts which were existing with the banks, within the banks, and they were the standard accounts. And also think of the kind of provisioning which banks had to do immediately on recognition of this. It was a tremendous amount of provisioning which had to be done. However, when the IBC came, the resolution process started. There was no exit route which was missing. So that exit route is working. We are still going through the processes, and I'm sure that we'll have a robust path ahead, and we'll learn from the experiences of the early resolution. So the health of the entire industry in the banking was such that it was dealing with high amount of NPAs, high amount of provisioning, capital adequacy is being at the very, very low margin. And in that context, came the recapitalization. And it's an unprecedented amount of recapitalization. And also came the similar issue as to what comes with the recapitalization. Is it a simple money which is going to go to the banks, or are there some reforms, are there some improvements, or it is just we are throwing good money after bad money? So the government has really been serious about it and announced a whole lot of reforms. And those reforms, as you are aware, or if I can just very quickly mention, those reforms have been divided into six verticals. The number one, it has been a differentiation in two ways. The first differentiation is, how do you allocate the capital? Whom do you give what, and on what basis, transparently? And the second is, what kind of differentiated banking thereafter banks do? So the differentiation in allocation and differentiation in the banking under the DBS, that's the differentiated banking strategy. What do they do with this kind of capital? So there are six verticals in which the reforms have been introduced, and the entire flow of capital is linked to the performance on the reforms. This is a very, very fundamental difference than what has been happening. So what are these reforms about? So how do you become responsible, and how do you become responsive? Under the overall theme, so responsibility comes from 3, 4, 5 things. I mean, there are a whole lot of reforms, and we have loaded it on the website also. So all of you can go through it, and if there are suggestions, we are always there to help you to sort of further ease the processes. But what does this essentially mean? You are all aware that joint lending forums were as big as 15, 16, 17, 18. It was a whole lot of problem to the genuine takers, and also it was prone to abuse. You have situations where cash flows are somewhere and the credit is somewhere. All that has been rationalized to say each one will have at least 10% exposure. So that means essentially 6 to 7 banks, it's much easier for everybody to deal with and to have a faster and cleaner systems. Then stress assets. We have talked of NPA, we haven't talked of SMEs. There are large number of SME accounts as well. What do you do to them? So they have been asked to put them together in a vertical called stress management vertical. Look at them, put your best talent there, help the entrepreneurs as to how you can resuscitate them rather than slipping it into NPAs. Then there are a whole lot of reforms on the customer sides, customer responsiveness. the very existence of brick and mortar branches is going to have a fundamental change in this technological era. It's not necessary that you go to bank. So why, how best you give all the facilities right from the comfort of home? That's what is the emphasis on each of the bank. How do you make through apps all facilities available right from the comfort of home? So it's on the customer sides. How do you take care of senior citizens? How do you talk of women entrepreneurs? I'll come to your point specifically. So then how do you make it entirely technology driven? And I'll come to MSME also specifically. The another aspect of the entire exercise has also been, and it should be, to ensure the financial inclusion in this country. If you look at the entire number of accounts of say around 110, 60 crore accounts are such that they are basic accounts. And funding the unfunded, it has received a very, very tremendous boost in terms of 30 crores accounts. And look at the shape of the economy, where is it going? It's the gem trinity, the accounts, the mobile, and the Aadhaar. That kind of a linkage is just once gives you a whole lot of facilities, right, sitting home. And one is going to introduce soon the OTP-based services so that you don't have to even visit the branches or the services. Then another thing which was generally not received that kind of emphasis which it should, how do you professionalize the management and the entire management structures of the bank? How do you empower the boards? How do you professionalize them? And how do you make them responsible? So it also reform suggests that, you know, every 3 months, every quarter, you bring all these important things to the board and just decide them. Have a look at that. So I'm sure that the differentiation, and after having adequately capitalized all the banks, we will see, I am hopeful, some very strong banks which we can have as a transformational thing, and as an aspirational country we can look for bigger roles, international role. Coming to MSME, we are very conscious of the fact that MSMEs constitute a great, it's a backbone of the entire system. If you look at the NSSO survey and see around 6.5 entrepreneurships establishments, so there are around, on an average, even if you take two, there would be something close to 11 to 12 crore employment which it generates. So there are a number of things which have happened there and which we are doing and which have already started. Number one is the online application platform and online tracking through udyamimitra.com. In one day after we announced this, there were 20,000 hits. And there are a whole lot of business which has already taken place. So what is in nutshell happening? There is no geographical requirement of a particular entrepreneur. He just puts it on the site where there are 200 already bank-approved projects already placed there, so that you don't go over and again to the scrutiny and approvals. Those accounts, banks keep looking at it, and 15 days time, which we are targeting, which is a very ambitious target for ourselves, that within 15 days, not only you look at that, the entrepreneur should be able to track it, and we should be able to give an answer to this. Then, putting them all, what are the problems? The problems relate to the cash flows, and problem relates to the market. These two also are being very significantly, we are attempting to sort it out through technology. The Trades platform, where you can discount your receivables, has already been introduced. All major PSUs, all major banks have either come on that platform or are in the process of coming onto that platform. And then now, as the Honorable FM announced in the budget, we are providing it a kind of a linkage or a validation with the GST and data points. So if a small enterprise has supplied some goods to the corporates, the data point is available in the GST and or on the trades, and the bill
till it is received back from the corporate becomes receivable and discounted by the bank. It helps the cash problems to a very, very large extent. Then, as you are aware, the limit corporate tax has also been reduced for the MSMEs up to a turnover of 250 crores. So all this put together is a great attempt to look at the entire MSME landscape. As you mentioned about the women entrepreneurs, both the points are very perfect. I'll definitely look at them, and this guarantee scheme, how do we extend it, how do we define the nature of the women entrepreneurship by 80%, 70% shareholding, that we will come out with. Now, another space, very briefly I'll touch on the entire rural economy side, which the budget has given a great boost to. It's a 14.63 lakh crores total amount which has been allocated. And it takes care of all the four aspects. The credit, which takes care of the input, the pricing, remunerative pricing, especially for kharif, where you pay the difference up to 150%. Then the infrastructure. In the infrastructure side, I will just, because that also gives a whole lot of opportunities for business in the rural areas, and which is growing faster. It looks after irrigation, storages, horticulture, aquaculture, Operation Blue, Operation Green, roads, sanitation, and most importantly, equally important, the mandis, the rural hearts. Budget specifically mentions about linking and upgrading all the rural hearts, mandis. So the plan is to invest at least 5 crores in each of these major 500 mandis and link them to NAM electronically, so that farmers also do not sell it during the distress. Without making it too long, I'll just touch on the insurance side also a bit. We're also looking at the insurance as the next sector of where we can increase our penetrations and where we can also have some synergies in scale. GIC, being the 12th largest global insurer, general insurer, has been listed last year. And this year, Honorable FM has announced already a listing and consolidation of 3 more general insurance companies. So this gives them the synergy if the boards find that, yes, there is a synergy required. And on the social security aspect, health scheme, I'm sure has been covered, but I'll just mention that there are 18.5 crore families which have already been provided the social security, accidental cover or a death cover of 2 lakh, which is a huge impact on the social security front and funding and taking care of the unfunded. So I would think this is the entire landscape in which we are working and which is the direction. And if there is anything in particular, I'll attempt and sort of answer that. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Can we have Sri Neeraj Gupta to give his address, and after that we'll have the round of Q&A, sir?
Mr. Shah, Somani, Mr. Patel, Dilip, Mr. Sanjay Baru, my colleague, Secretary DFS, Mr. Rajiv, members of the National Executive who are present here. Disinvestment may not be the topic where you may be finding value for direct investment by the enterprises and the organizations which you all are representing. But one way or the other, CPSEs had been the instrument of growth and economic development in this country. And many of the industries have really taken cues and taken lead in many cases, beyond their expertise, and created much better business proposition in the enterprise sector. But this department used to be Department of Disinvestment. And when it was a unilateral disinvestment, probably it doesn't seem to have any meaning for enterprises who are working independent of CPSEs. But today there is a paradigm shift. We are Department of Investment and Public Asset Management. And that paradigm shift opens up lot of opportunities for enterprises to either co-work or even acquire business from CPSEs. So that element has to be understood. Let me say disinvestment proceeds are mere incidental. And definitely if we are selling something, the fair value has to come to the government accounts. Unlocking the value of the enterprises is one of the elements of investment management. And in this very process, there are two tracks which are being pursued. One is more and more companies are getting listed. So many of you who may be interested in investing other than your own business, there are a lot of opportunities opening in public sector, that too in defense, railways, insurance. We have already listed two insurance companies, two big enterprises. Another 8-10 are in the pipeline, and defense and defense insurance and railways, which was never thought of that it will be open for public investment, it is getting opened up. Another is strategic divestment. Nearly 24 companies are being privatized, and we are looking for why we are privatizing them. Not that government wants to make money or divest or want to exit only because they have some intention of making money. No. We felt that the competition has come of the age where a lot of private players are there in the same fields. They are doing much better business. Their expertise, their technology, their management skills, the fresh investment, it is definitely required to unlock the true potential of these enterprises. And why should we not give it to private sector where they can be expanded manifold and create wealth for the nation? The whole idea is the business should be done more like a business. And if government is not in a position to expand them for any constraint, and private sector has demonstrated a lot of strength, it is no more market distorting to divest them. Is better to divest. So large number of companies are already on the block. Many more will come up. And I'm sure most of the entrepreneurs here will find a lot of value in aspiring to acquire such companies and creating wealth in these brownfield projects which are already existing. Second issue which I like to share with my friends here, I have interacted with many of you in my previous avatar in Commerce and Industries Ministry, where I served for 6-7 years. None of the corporate entities and none of the government have very clear laid down dividend policy in their set. Some corporate entities who have given 100% of the PAT as dividend if they don't need that money to be retained and leveraged further. As an investor, we are saying that you have to leverage your equity, you have to leverage your net worth, you have to expand your business one way or the other. You cannot sit on idle cash, or if you are sitting on idle cash, then reward your investors. That such an upfront policy of the government is not visible in any other corporate world, whether it is developing world or developed world. Now, creating value for the enterprise's third basic principle which we are following. There, mergers and acquisition in the CPSE space and leveraging, which I mentioned, are the two broad thrusts. We are promoting them to expand their business either by leveraging and expanding in the core business segment, or if they feel within the CPSE space there can be value addition to that enterprise by acquiring more business, we are in principle committed. If there is an economic rationale, you're welcome. You have seen some deals, you will see some more deals. Even in the budget, merger of three general insurance companies, and then their listing has been announced so that the enterprise value is adequately created before the listing. Now, we are not simply passively seeing CPSEs. If they have to leverage, they have to leverage more efficiently also. So new instruments, like we have conceived a debt ETF. We are in the process of conceiving a debt ETF so that CPSEs, which are raising almost 3 lakh crores from the market through bond route individually, their strength can be leveraged, their efficiency of bonds can be further improved. If their cost of borrowing goes down, their capacity to expand business goes up. And we are looking more and more towards the investors, largely the retail investor, HNIs, pension funds. So a fund of fund concept has come in this budget, whereby if you are a non-demat account holder, folio investor, through fund of fund route, you can have access to any ETFs, equity ETFs. So whether it's the equity ETF created around Sensex or Nifty or CPSE or even Bharat 22, so which the CPSE and Bharat 22 are two indexes which have been promoted by government. So these tools have been also put to use. And Bharat 22, if I talk about yields, CPSE ETFs and Bharat 22 is outperforming Sensex and Nifty. So I can say with a lot of pride that generally the treatment of investors is much, much better in public sector enterprises, and public and investor is having a lot of confidence. That's why CPSE index and Bharat 22 both are better performing than the broader indexes or benchmark indexes. Thank you very much. I don't know whether we have some question in this segment, but you're welcome if you have any. Thank you.